do that.
Yeah, Jeff Zeleny, appreciate it from the White House. With me now, Professor Alan Dershowitz, Ashram Gappa, and Milgram, and Michael Zeldin. Professor Dershowitz is author of the new book, Trumped Up, How Criminalization of Political Differences Endangers Democracy. Professor Dershowitz, do you think this is heading toward a subpoena?
I do. I think we may be seeing some posturing now. We may be seeing some attempts of both sides to flex some muscles. We're going to give you a subpoena. Oh, yeah? Well, we're going to do this and that and the other thing. It may still end up with a narrow 4-hour or 6-hour conversation between the president and the special counsel.
You think they could do it in 6, because those 49 questions.
That's the whole point.
That seems like days.
That may be a negotiating position. Because if you are doing those questions, what's the possible benefit for the president to sit down? The only possible benefit the president gets by volunteering and giving up his rights is if he can narrow the questions. He can refuse to answer questions in certain areas. But if they're going to ask him about everything, might as well take it to the courts and fight.
But isn't there a slight advantage, Asha, that if he's not in front of a grand jury, his lawyers can be present and can involve themselves in this?
Right. So he'll have his counsel there. And I think it also, you know, he can still narrow the scope or refuse to answer certain questions as they're asking follow-ups, for example. This is the questions that are laid out are big, broad brush questions. Right. And each of them will generate follow-up questions. But I think that we need to remember that this presidency is kind of like a choose-your-own-adventure where every ending ends in a constitutional crisis of some kind. The ideal situation is that he sits down and does it. I do have to agree with Alan. It's probably not in his interest because he does not have a command of the facts or the discipline to answer in the way that he should.
And Jeff Toobin in the last hour suggested, Jeff thinks he would take the Fifth and that would eliminate all this problem. Professor Dershowitz said absolutely no way he shouldn't do that.
I don't know that I think he takes the Fifth either. I think it's incredibly perilous for him to take the Fifth. I mean, essentially he said, I have nothing to hide. I'll have the conversation. To then take the Fifth Amendment basically says that he would be incriminating himself if he spoke, and he'd be basically saying that he's guilty of a crime. And so I think, you know, that's more of a political question, but I think that is probably the least likely option that he's going to want to go through. Mm-hmm.
Michael Zeldin, do you see this heading toward a subpoena?
If they don't reach an agreement, I think that's where Mueller will take it. You know, my time with Bob tells me that he believes that his mandate here is to find out what happened and that he's going to follow the facts to find out whether those facts lead to law violations or not, and that the president is not going to dictate to him the terms under which he does his fact-finding. Remember that the team that Mueller has is Michael Dreeben. Michael Dreeben is one of the most accomplished Supreme Court criminal appellate advocates. I expect the issue of whether or not the president can be subpoenaed to give oral testimony has been well briefed by Dreeben, and that Mueller feels that he's on solid legal ground to make that request to Dowd at the time known, that they will follow that route.
Mm-hmm. Professor Dershowitz, though, I mean, to Jeff Zeleny's point, if this does go the way to the courts, this could go on for a year.
Well, it could go on for a year. I suspect it first gets to the district court, and the district court splits the difference. And the district court says you must answer questions about your business dealings before you became president. You must answer some questions that you may have waived or other areas. But there are going to be some questions about your motives, your reasons, your intentions that the court will probably say is beyond the power of the grand jury. Now, the interesting question is whether or not the argument that I've made, that is, you can't call a subject into a grand jury in order to give him an opportunity to commit perjury. You have to do it in order to get information you don't already have, whether that kind of argument will prevail. It could go both ways on that.
But actually, don't prosecutors all the time ask questions that they know the answers to?
Mm-hmm. That they precisely ask questions that they already know the answer
right.
to. And I think that I disagree with Alan. They need to get his answers on motive, because that is precisely on what the obstruction case turns. It's whether what he was thinking when he fired James Comey and what happened before and after. And we have this litany of actions, including his own tweets and interviews, for him to explain. So I don't see how you could shield that.
Of course it's relevant, but it's also privileged. You know, you can't ask a senator or congressman to explain their vote. You can't
Alan,
ask
USB
a judge
Nixon says
to
that
explain
if it's
vote.
Not privileged, if it's not a legitimate policy decision-making or national security related,
it
if it's evidence of a crime,
security.
If it's evidence of a crime, it can be pierced.
Would they have asked President Bush why he gave a pardon to Caspar Weinberger. When the special prosecutor said that pardon to Caspar Weinberger and five others was motivated by a desire to end the prosecution, to continue the cover-up, everybody agreed with that, but everybody also agreed you can't ask the president that question. The president, if he has the authority to do something, has the authority to do it for any reason. He can pardon, he can fire, he can do all of these things. So it's not that it's not relevant, it's that privilege trumps relevance.
Well, except that privilege really applies here to a very narrow set of questions that we see in the among the 49. As you say, Professor Dershowitz, anything that predates the president's inauguration is not covered
right.
by privilege.
Right.
Anything that is not advice that he receives from his advisors, his senior advisors, is not executive privilege protected. With respect to the question of whether or not he can be asked about his motives in firing people that he has a constitutional right to do, that may be one small area that the courts can, you know, battle over. But everything else is really not covered by this. And of course, the issue is, in a court setting, is one forum. In an impeachment hearing analysis, it's completely different because the Fifth Amendment and all those things do not apply outside of the courtroom.
Right.
And that's another whole aspect of what's going on here, too.
And also, if the president did receive immunity in order to
yeah,
answer questions,
compelled, yep.
things he says, though, legally he would be fine, but it could be used in impeachment proceedings, correct?
Yes, that's correct. And also, I mean, think about, that's correct. And think about also the fact that, you know, he would be testifying as well and providing information about other people.
Mm.
So, you know, we're very focused right now on the president being the person that we're that is the target of this, not using target in the legal sense, but using, you know, the point person for these interviews. But there's a lot in those questions that relate to other people as well. So, you know, immunity doesn't take him off the hook on impeachment, and immunity doesn't, you know, he also doesn't have the right to invoke the Fifth Amendment for other people.
And frankly, some of those people are family members. And we're talking
correct.
About Jared Kushner, we're talking
that's
about
correct.
Donald Trump Jr.
On one point, I think the timing question, I'm not so sure it takes years, because I think this is such an extraordinary matter that courts would move as quickly as possible. Now, the parties would still need reasonable time to brief it and get to the court, but I think this is the kind of thing that would move as quickly as humanly possible in the courts.
I agree.
I think it's already briefed. I think on Mueller's side, it's already briefed.
I agree.
I think Dreeben has briefed this, and they're ready to pull the plug if the president resists, which the new lawyers, Sekulow, the Raskins, and Giuliani, have to realize that.
It's interesting, though, in the reporting from the Washington Post, we learned that these 49 questions were not questions that, these were written down by, according to the Post, by Jay Sekulow,
right.
the president's own attorney. So the president, who is critical of this stuff leaking out, it seems like if Jay Sekulow is the one who wrote down these 49 questions, it's not as if they were leaked by Robert Mueller.
Right,
they came from someone
absolutely.
In the president's
access,
orbit.
Right.
Absolutely.
Right.
And not only that, they may have contained privileged information because they were his characterizations of the questions, and he had a right to give that to the president in a lawyer-client privileged way. And if somebody in the White House leaked that, they may have breached the privilege too, but we know this White House just leaks like a sieve.
Yeah.
And that raises the other last question as it relates to whether they would prevail in a court, which is, I think Alan Dershowitz raised it earlier, which is waiver.
Right.
And that the president may well have waived that small area of law that protects him, his deliberative process, privilege stuff, he may well have waived that. Mm. And so he sits there, you know, pretty legally naked when it comes to trying to resist this subpoena if one is issued.
I think that overstates it. Now, a president does have the authority to speak to the public, and I think the courts would find waiver only in extreme cases. So I don't think he's completely naked. I think he's partly exposed. I don't want to use the metaphor of Putin. He probably has his shirt off, but he still has his pants on.
Oh my gosh.
All right, let's not go down that metaphor anymore. Thanks, everybody. More on the breaking news after a quick break.
Bear Marquee presents It's Got Potential.
I think it'll look